Love by S.T. Coleridge, presented by Dr. Vinamrata. Hello dear students, today we are going to critically appreciate a poetry written by Samuel Taylor Coleridge titled Love. It is also read as All Thoughts, All Passions, All Delight, because these are the starting lines, or actually this is the starting line of the poetry. Now, before proceeding on to the poem, a little bit about Coleridge. We all know that he was the person who started off Romanticism in England, and he and Wordsworth, joint venture, lyrical ballads, started off the new form of new rise of Romanticism in England, where the poetry was deviated from its original form and a new variation was seen. And the basic special or unique feature of Coleridge was his romanticism and his supernatural, his use of supernatural, his use of fancy, his use of, because further in his critical works he goes on explaining about primary imagination, secondary imagination and fancy. And when he talks about all these things, he very well says that how supernatural also is a form in which your feelings, your emotions can be expressed. And he has used it a lot in his poetries, be it your Kubla Khan or be it your the rhyme of the ancient mariner. And here also in this poem, although it is a love poetry, although it goes on a single plain tone about the story between a lover and his beloved, but the fairy tale like atmosphere that it creates a strange aura which makes you feel that you are driven into some different world, which gives you a sense of beyond this world, of something supernatural going all around. It gives you, and there are the mentions of the fiend and witches and the caves and mountains and riding and all those romantic notions. It all brings you to a vision of a different world. It will take you into a different plane. So it is also a kind of fairy tale story, a fairy tale kind of narration, and the use of supernatural can be seen by Coleridge here. So let's start with the poetry straightforward. It is a very long poem, and when talking about the structure of the poem, it is divided into 24 stanzas, and all the stanzas are written in quatrains. That means it has got 4 lines each, and the rhyme scheme which he is following here is ABCB. So the second and the third alternating second and the fourth alternating lines rhyme, whereas the first and the third do not rhyme. And the first 3 lines of each stanza is written in iambic tetrameter, whereas the last line of the stanzas are written in iambic trimeter. So you see a very unique kind of writing technique Coleridge has used here, and this also shows his romantic vein, because he is not following the ancient patterns which was still now followed. There is pattern, there is stanza, there is meter, there is rhyme and rhythm, but he has adopted a different kind of meter which is not generally used. So that is the structure of the poetry. Now coming to the theme of the poem, the poem is about love and is full of emotional sensibility. The poem unfolds in the form of a story about a beautiful lady named Genevieve, and this lady, she is being wooed by a knight, but she continuously refuses the proposal of the knight, and this is the whole story. The knight woos the lady and she refuses, and how at last she reconciles, but of no use. So the poetry deals on details with the love a knight feels for the lady. He refers to her as the lady of the land, but she does not reciprocate at first, and it drives him mad. He travels throughout the country to just shake off the image, the recurring image of the lady which keeps on coming in his mind, and he is unable to shake off that image and the presence of the lady which he feels always around him. So this also is a eerie kind of feeling which is generated by Coleridge and gives you a supernatural essence. And eventually he comes upon a group of brutal men trying to rape a woman, and he leaps in. He tries to save, and when he objects and he fights, the final climax is that it turns out that the woman he saved was the same lady that he loved. So he saves her, but in due process he is mortally wounded and he cannot survive anymore, and he succumbs to his bruises, he succumbs to his wounds, and he dies. So the lady now has learned to love him, but it is of no use because the knight is now dead. So that is the main gist of the story, that is the main summary of the poetry. And line by line, if we take up the poetry, it is divided into 24 stanzas. So the first stanza reads in this way: all thoughts, all passion, all delight, whatever stirs this mortal frame, all are but minstrels of fate and feed this sacred flame. Often my waking dreams do I live over again that happy hour when midway on the mount I lay beside the ruined tower. So it talks about the essence of what love is, and he says that whatever thoughts, whatever passion, whatever delight, means whatever emotion a person feels, it is nothing but because of love. So any thought, any passion, any delight, whatever comes in the mind of any man or any person is nothing but, they are nothing but ministers of love. And here love is personified, because when the emotions attributed are ministers of love, then obviously love becomes the king. And love here is personified being the king, the master of the all. And he says that that is the frame, that is the thing. Love is the main essence to which everything is feeded. So love is like a sacred flame. It is something burning, something kindled, and to it all the emotions are feeded. And so means in one liner he's trying to say, Coleridge is trying to say, that love is all encompassing, love is the most important thing, and love is the most prominent essence of what a man is made of. So in the second stanza, the speaker narrates the story in the first person, and the story of the knight and the lady Genevieve is narrated by this first person. So the person looks back into time and talks about some daydreams, some waking dreams that he is talking about. Those dreams when is of those times when he was happy. It was of the happy hour that he talks about, when there was once upon a time when he used to lay down on a mountain and beside the ruined tower, and he used to enjoy that place, that tower, that mountain, that aloofness, that being away from the world. And here only, from here only, the fairy tale like narrative starts. And stanza 3 and 4: the moonshine stealing over the scene has blended with the lights of eve, and she was there, my hope, my joy, my own dear Genevieve. She leant against the armed man, the statue of the armed knight. She stood and listened to my lay amid the lingering light. So he's already told about the place where he was. He was on a mountain and there was a tower there, and he was relaxing there. And he says that it is the time of the evening, and because there is evening, there are different shades of light coming from maybe stars and moon that is stealing over the scene. The moonshine is stealing over the scene and is blending with the evening lights, because in evening certain homes and the people around have also burnt up their lamps or some kind of luminous bodies to give light. So those luminous bodies from the earth, as well as the heavenly bodies, moon and stars, all the lights from the earth and the heaven are mixing, and it is all there around the surroundings. And amidst those lights he can see there, along with him, there is some person. Who is that? She is nobody else but the lady Genevieve. She is only the joy, the hope, everything for the author. And in the fourth stanza he talks about the knight, because Genevieve is there, so she has gone there to meet the knight. So he introduces the main character in the fourth stanza, that is the knight. and Genevieve is described as the hope and the joy, whereas the knight is described as the armed man because he is a chivalrous, a valorful man, and against him she is leaning, and the knight is standing like a statue. He is so tall and muscular, and he is leaning against the lady is leaning against the knight, and she stood and listened to my lay amid the lingering light. So see, there are two stories going line by line, hand by hand. There is one story about the knight and the lady of the land, that is Genevieve, and the other story is about the poet and his beloved. And he says that he is narrating this whole story of the knight and the lady of the land to the beloved in the form of a lay. He says that she stood and listened to my lay. So that lay is a kind of musical short lyric poem. So in the form of a poem, he is narrating the story of the knight and the lady of the land to his own beloved, and he along with the beloved is there present at that place. And in the story, there is another story going on. In the story of the poet and the beloved, another story is going on, is being narrated by the poet to the lady, and that is the story of the knight and Genevieve. And he says that she also stood there listening to my lay. Now this, she is the beloved of the poet, and she was also standing amidst the lingering light. Stanza 5 and 6. Few sorrows hath she of her own, my hope, joy, my Genevieve. She loves me best whenever I sing the songs that make her grieve. I played a soft and doleful air, I sang an old and moving story, an old rude song that suited well that ruin wild and hoary. So they are standing on a mount near a tower, and it is a ruined place, a deserted place, and he says that in that deserted place he is narrating a deserted kind of ruined kind of story to the lady, and that story makes the music sad, makes the environment also sad. The environment becomes heavy because of the love story that he is narrating to the lady, and the love story he is narrating is a tragic tale actually, because at the end the lovers don't meet. So that's why the air also around them becomes heavy. And he says that although he loves Genevieve so much, she is his hope and his joy, but she never loves back. But she is enjoying the story, the song that is narrated by the poet to her. And through that song, actually, he is trying to convey his own emotions also. The same emotions that the knight felt is the emotion of the poet also. That's why he is narrating this story to Genevieve, and through the song, through the singing, he is going to give her all the details that he feels about Genevieve. And he says that the song makes her grieve, the place becomes hoary and doleful, mournful. Why? Because obviously the story that he is telling is a very emotional one, and it is tragic at the end. So the lady is becoming perplexed by this tragic tale. So the next stanza, we move on to stanza 7 and 8. She listened with a flitting blush, with downcast eyes and modest grace. For well she knew I could not choose but gaze upon her face. I told her of the knight that wore upon his shield a burning brand, and that for 10 long years he wooed the lady of the land. So he tells her the story of the knight who for 10 long years keep on wooing the lady of the land. And while telling the story, he kept on gazing towards the lady's face. And because of his gazing, continuous gaze, the lady is so modest that she starts blushing, and she downcasts her eyes. So that shows the beauty of the lady, that shows the modesty of the lady. And he tells her the story of how the knight was very chivalrous. He had a burning hand, burning brand upon his shield, and he was, this shows his chivalrous structure of the night. But although he was so brave, so chivalrous, he kept on praying to the lady. He kept on wooing to the lady, but the lady kept on refusing him. And in the stanza 9, 10, 11 and 12, again that story continues. Because he kept on wooing and the lady never reciprocated back, what happened? I told her how he pined, and the deep, the low, the pleading tone with which I sang another's love interpreted my own. She listened with a flitting blush, with downcast eyes and modest grace, and she forgave me that I gazed too fondly on her face. But when I told the cruel scorn that crazed that bold and lovely knight, and that he crossed the mountain woods, nor rested day nor night, that sometimes from the savage den, and sometimes from the darksome shade, and sometimes starting up at once in green and sunny glade. So he says, he continues the story and says that because the knight kept on wooing the lady and the lady never reciprocated back, he was pining for the love of the lady. He kept on pleading, he kept on getting low, bowing down towards her, but she never reciprocated back. And when he is telling all these things, he says that I am interpreting, I am telling someone else's story, I am singing someone else's story, but I am interpreting my own story. So through that story, through the story of the knight, he is trying to tell the lady the story or the condition of his own heart. And the lady also, again he says, that is very blushful, and she listens to the story with a blush. But this time again the poet is continuously gazing at the lady, but she does not gets angry, or she does not shows any kind of reproach in her eyes, and in fact she looks back with a fond face. So earlier there was downcast eyes, now also there is downcast eyes, but that down, after that downcast eyes, she is again putting up her head and putting or looking up towards the poet with a fond face. So somewhere or the we are seeing some changes of emotion in the lady. Earlier she was totally shy, now a bit of openness can be seen. And the story continues, the story of the knight continues, and because he was so cruelly scorned and spurned upon, and he was not his love was not reciprocated, what happened? That the lovely knight went mad. He was crazed by this, and that's why he left this place and went towards the mountains and woods, roaming around in the jungles, not resting even for days or night. He kept on walking and riding, and sometimes he would reach some savage den, and sometimes he would reach some forest which was very dark, and in this way sometimes sunny, sometimes dark places were visited by the knight. He kept on like a nomad, like a madman, he kept on hunting and visiting places without resting for even once. Now the last, the 13, 14, 15 and 16 stanzas, again the story continues, and it talks about how the emotional turmoil brews up in the mind of the knight, and it is like this. There came and looked him in the face an angel beautiful and bright, and that he knew it was a feint, this miserable knight, and that unknowing what he did, he leaped amid a murderous band and saved from outrage worse than death the lady of the land. And how she wept, clasped his knees, and how she tended him in vain, and even strove to expiate the scorn that crazed his brain, and that she nursed him in a cave, and how his madness went away when on the yellow forest leaf a dying man he lay. So because he was so much in emotional turmoil, he went out not knowing where he is going, and trying to drive away the face that kept on appearing in his mind. He was kind of hallucinating every time the face of the lady, and it was an angelic face, very beautiful and bright, and every time, everywhere he went, that face kept on coming in front of him. But although it was an angelic face, it was very beautiful, obviously it was the face of the lady, so it was a very beautiful face, but he knew that it is in disguise. The face that he's seeing is beautiful, it is angelic, but in reality it is the face of a witch, it is the face of a fiend, he says. Why? Because she has refused his proposal, and that's why it has driven him mad, and that madness is continuing. He cannot get rid of that madness. He is becoming totally crazy. So somewhere or the other, although the face is very beautiful, but it is becoming a kind of witch-like thing for the knight. And in that same way, the knight was very miserable, and unknowingly what he is doing, what he is not doing, suddenly he comes across a band or group of murderous people, robbers, some kind of barbaric people who were trying to kind of rape a lady. And there he leaps in front of them, tries to save the lady, actually saves her. And what he finds out at the end was that she was the lady who he loved. Till now he was not knowing who he is going to save. But after saving her, he comes to realize the fact that it was the lady herself. And now she realizes the real love. Now she understands that the knight is in true love with the lady. And she claps his knees and tries to tend him because he is very badly wounded in saving her. So he is tended by the lady. And she even drives away the fact, till now she used to scorn the knight, now she even leaves that behind, and in fact is ready to accept the knight. But she nursed him, she kept on trying to tend him. That love, that affair that she showed towards the knight, it somehow or the other drove away the madness, drove away the craziness which the knight was facing. But is it of any use now? No, because now he's a dying man. He's on the verge of death, lying on the yellow forest leaves, and no one can save him now. His dying words, but when I reached that tenderest strain of all the ditty, my faltering voice and pausing heart disturbed her soul with pity. All impulses of soul and sense had thrilled my guileless Genevieve, the music and the doleful tale, the rich and balmy eve, and hopes and fears that kindle hope, an undistinguishable throng, and gentle wishes long subdued and cherished long. She wept with pity and delight, she blushed with love and virgin shame, and like the murmur of a dream, I heard her breathe my name. So now, in the story which the poet was narrating, there is change of events, and the knight suddenly is appreciated by the lady of the land, and she starts loving the knight. And here also the thoughts are changing. Genevieve, who was the lady of the poet, who was the love of the poet, is also seeing or facing some kind of change of emotions. And she is also thrilled, and the tale, the music, and the doleful, the mournful tale that he was telling till now has disturbed her soul. She is full of pity, and the voice of the poet is also shaking, it is faltering, because till now he has reached the climax where the knight is on the verge of the death, and that is somewhere or the other disturbing the poet, and because of that the poet's voice is faltering, and his harp, the harp that he was playing, the musical instrument, is also paused, and it has very much disturbed the lady Genevieve, and she is feeling pity for the knight, and also it is kindling some kind of hope in the heart of the lady. And till now the feelings that was subdued, till now the feelings and emotions that she was suppressing, comes to the forefront. She was till now full of, actually not scorned, but yes, she was not accepting the proposal of the poet. But now she is weeping. She is weeping with pity and also with happiness. She is blushing with love. She is totally encompassed with the full emotions. And there is shame which can be seen, the virgin shame. Why virgin shame? Because she is not ashamed of anything actually. She is actually blushing. And at last the poet can hear Genevieve utter the name of the poet. And like the murmur of a dream, as if it was coming in a dream, he just not could not accept this fact that the lady has uttered out his name. And the poet could hear her breathing out his name. And these are the last four stanzas. Her bosom heaved, she stepped aside. As conscious of my look, she stepped. Then suddenly, with tremulous eye, she fled to me and wept. Till now, two times we have seen, at one, the poet was totally gazing at the lady and she was totally blushful. At the second time, she looked back, and this is the third time when again he is gazing at the lady, but this time she is not blushing, she is coming towards the poet. So this shows the change of emotions. Till now, her heart has become very heavy, her bosom is heavy with the story and with some kind of guilt also, because till now she was not accepting the poet and she feels that we don't know what the fate may show us. So at least she should have accepted the proposal earlier. And she is conscious of the looks of the poet, but now she does not look away, she does not blush away, but she comes towards the poet. And she half enclosed me with her arms. She pressed me with a meek embrace, and bending back her head, looked up and gazed upon my face. So now she has the courage to look up toward the poet and see him onto his face. She embraces him, not a total hug, but a little bit of embrace, a meek embrace. She puts around her arms, she puts her arms around the poet, and she looks towards the face of the poet. She also gazes back. That was partly love and partly fear. So he says that that was not totally love. She is not totally hugging him tightly. A little bit of distance is till now there. That was partly love and partly fear, and partly was a bashful art, that I might rather feel than see the swelling of her heart. I claimed her fears, and she was calm, and told her love with virgin pride. And so I won my Genevieve, my bright and beauteous bride. So at the last we see the story has a happy ending. He somehow calms her down. He claims her fears, means gives her some kind of consolations, calms her, says her that he will always be there with her. She has nothing to fear, and that makes her even more proud. And she accepts the proposal. Actually, she reciprocates back. She claims back her love for the poet. And in that way, finally, after narrating her the tale of the knight and the lady of the land, he finally wins the heart of Genevieve. And finally, Genevieve becomes the beauteous bride of the poet. So that was all about this poetry. These are the 24 stanzas. And the poem thus narrates an amazing love story like that of a Romeo and Juliet. And we also know that how ultimately Romeo and Juliet died, where the lovers never united at the end. So the story which was narrated there, the lovers never united at the end, the knight and the lady of the land, but the poet finally finds back the lady. Although tragic in nature, it establishes the concept of true love. And obviously it has got a fairy tale like aura, and that is the speciality of Coleridge and his romanticism. So that was all about this poetry. Thank you.